Mayor Olivia Chow says if Toronto is going to succeed, it has to be more affordable to live here. The city outlines its vision for the economy. Good afternoon. The mayor says there also has to be an increase in good jobs.
It's all part of a 10-year action plan for the economy. CTV's Natalie Johnson joins us now live downtown with more. Natalie.
Well, Nathan, this plan acknowledges that Toronto is at a crossroads due to the disparity of wealth across the city. And as a result, the livability of the city is at stake. This action plan really laying out a roadmap moving forward, as it does have serious implications for the ability to attract talent and investment to Toronto. So the plan to address these issues really focuses in on creating strong main streets with supports for small businesses, creating quality jobs, and ensuring global competitiveness while supporting Toronto's high-value sectors, acknowledging that everything from congestion to affordable housing will play a role in the livability of this city moving forward. Here is more from the mayor and the budget chief this morning.
We must build more affordable homes. Why? Because if their homes are affordable, they don't have to pay as much rent or the mortgage, which means they would have money left over to go eat and shop locally. That will create a stronger small businesses, better Main Street. Because without that, it's difficult to grow the middle class.
Create quality local jobs, jobs that bring living wages and the ability to house oneself. And we have to increase our global competitiveness to attract the top talent and investment from every corner of the globe. We know we're competing on that world stage, and we're able to compete with this plan.
This is very much a big picture plan that outlines a number of smaller targets, but the city is hopeful that if those can be achieved, the city will double its GDP within 25 years. Reporting live downtown, I'm Natalie Johnson. Nathan, over to you.
Thank you, Natalie. Still to come, another major story we're watching out of Ottawa as Prime Minister Trudeau testifies at the inquiry into foreign interference.
But first, we take a live look outside. Sunshine greeting us to start the day. Definitely some clouds in the mix. And it is cool, but not as chilly as it felt yesterday. Jessica Smith is here with a look at the current conditions. What are you seeing, Jess?
We're slowly getting warmer, right? It was chilly yesterday. It'll be chilly again this evening, but really as we head in towards the end of the week, things start to rebound quite nicely if you like the warmer fall weather. A little cloudy right now, but Michelle is right. We saw lots of sunshine this morning, and we'll see more as we head into the afternoon. Any shower activity kind of holding on just west of us, but for the most part, we are just looking at some cloud cover midday before a little more sun rolls in later on this afternoon and then before the sun sets this evening. Temperature-wise, it's obviously still a little fresh. We're in the single digits right now, but it will get warmer as we make our way into the afternoon. We're at about 9 through the islands, 8 through Pearson, still that northwesterly wind adding that coolness to the air. This afternoon, it's not so bad, but tonight it gets chilly. Your full forecast coming up right now. It's back over to Nathan and Michelle.
Thank you, Jess. In Ottawa, the Prime Minister testified this morning at the federal inquiry into foreign interference.
Justin Trudeau told the inquiry he is limited in what he can say and do, particularly during an election campaign.
There actually are significant limits on how and whether ministers and prime minister to continue to be ministers or prime ministers even during an election. But they are limited in what they can actually go out and say, particularly if they're about to say that an opposition party is compromised or benefiting from interference by a third country in an election context. That would be destabilizing and you know, of concern to do.
Trudeau says the world is less safe than ever due to the rise of authoritarian powers that are determined to sow chaos in democracies like Canada. He spoke today about the allegations that the Indian government was involved in the death of a Canadian man in BC last year.
In late July, early August, I was briefed on the fact that there was intelligence from Canada and possibly from Five Eyes allies that made it fairly clear, credibly clear, that India was involved in this killing. Agents of the government of India were involved in the killing of a Canadian on Canadian soil. This was something that we obviously had to take extremely seriously. That violation of sovereignty, of the international rule of law, with extrajudicial killing in a foreign country, in a fellow democracy, was a massive mistake.
Trudeau also testified today that he trusts his national security advisor to determine what information needs to reach him the most on foreign interference. These latest hearings are looking at the ability of institutions to detect and fend off meddling attempts by hostile states.
We'll be getting a show and tell today from Canada Border Services on how it's been trying to curb vehicle theft.
A news conference is being held in less than an hour, and we go to our Rahim Ladani, who joins us now from Halton Regional Police, 2 District, with more on what to expect. Rahim.
Michelle and Nathan, good afternoon. We're going to be hearing from the Minister of Transport, Anita Anand, and she'll be providing an update on the National Action Plan to combat auto theft. Auto theft has been an alarming trend across the country. In fact, every 6 minutes a vehicle is stolen. That equates to about 90,000 vehicles stolen. And this is not a victimless crime. Aside from the inconvenience of having your vehicle stolen or the fear that it instills in people, it also costs Canadians. In fact, between taxpayers and insurance policyholders, auto theft costs Canadians $1.2 billion per year. Now, when the federal government launched this action plan about 5 months ago, they said they wanted to focus on 3 pillars: legislative, communication, and technology. From a legislative standpoint, they wanted to make changes to the criminal code to hold people more culpable that were involved in this type of criminal activity. A communication standpoint, they wanted to increase communication between the Canada Border Services Agency, RCMP, and local municipalities, also internationally with Interpol. And then from a technology standpoint, they wanted to do a better job of actually scanning shipping containers at rail yards and ports before stolen vehicles are shipped overseas to Africa and the Middle East. In fact, Canada Border Services Agency says to date, they have already recovered 1,890 stolen vehicles. Compare that to the 1,800 that were recovered in all of last year, and you can see that some progress is being made. And so it'll be interesting to hear from the minister today to see where things stand in terms of the progress that's been made in the past 5 months and the vision for this national action plan moving forward. Again, that's going to be happening at 1 o'clock here in Halton, and we'll be here to have all the details. Reporting live, I'm Rahim Ladani. I'll send it back to you both in studio.
Thank you, Rahim. The province is bracing for a huge increase in the demand for electricity.
A new forecast has been released by the province. CTV's Queen's Park Bureau Chief Siobhan Morris joins us live with more details. Siobhan.
Well, we already knew that the demand for power was climbing fast as the province grows and our habits change. But the Ontario Electricity System Operator says we're going to need even more power than they thought just a year ago. A demand for power in Ontario is expected to climb by 75% by 2050. That's 15% higher than was forecast just a year ago. Now, energy to power electric vehicle production in Ontario, all those plants coming online, they make up a big chunk of that. We'll need to add capacity that could power something the size of the city of Toronto to make those plants work. Also driving up demand is our reliance on AI technology. That gobbles up more power than we see used in traditional web-based services.
Data center demand alone is forecast to make up 4% of provincial demand in Ontario by 2035.
I think Ontarians should be confident that we have a plan to generate, store, and obviously conserve energy in the province. We are well ahead of our peers right across the country and the world. We not only do we have enough energy for the years to come, but we just launched Canada's largest competitive procurement, equivalent to generating or storing energy for 5 million homes. And I wrote to our system operator saying, bring me back options to expand it and accelerate its implementation.
Minister Lecce says he'll be introducing the plan of how we get all those new power generating projects online in time and affordably in the next few days. Reporting live from Queen's Park, I'm Siobhan Morris. Michelle, back to you.
Thank you, Siobhan. Metrolinx has parted ways with 2 members of its senior management team. According to an internal memo obtained by CTV Toronto, a chief planning officer and a chief operating officer of Rapid Transit were both let go. Metrolinx says their mandate has grown in scope in recent years and there was a need to evolve and adapt. Phil Tabernier has been tasked with getting the long-delayed Eglinton and Finch West LRTs into service. The most recent update from Metrolinx on the Eglinton crosstown means the line won't open this year, and there is still no indication on when it will be in operation.
Ontario Liberal leader Bonnie Crombie is calling on the Ford government to renegotiate its Ontario Place deal.
This mega spa is a mega scam. They're paying $1 billion less in rent than the Treasury Board guidelines or fair market value would require. He's also giving away hundreds of millions of your tax dollars to build a parking lot. And he's making you foot the bill for maintenance and work to prepare the site for construction. And I'm here today with my colleagues, Dr. Shamji and Stephanie Bowman, to expose this terrible deal.
The Ford government released the terms of its 95-year lease with Atherma earlier this month. It includes the right to terminate the lease early with 5 years' notice after the facility's been in operation for 10 years. Meanwhile, the Ontario Green Party says the premier is focused on the wrong priorities.
What people are telling me everywhere I go over and over is that they want us to address the housing crisis because that's what's driving the affordability crisis. They want to be able to have access to a family doctor. They want their kids to be in a classroom that's not overcrowded. They want to be able to save money by saving energy. Those are the real issues that the people of Ontario are concerned about, and the premier is clearly out of touch.
The Ontario legislature is set to resume next week. Latvian state police are investigating the death of a Canadian soldier. Captain Aaron Weidman died Sunday in the city of Riga while off duty. The military did not provide further details. Weidman was posted within the Latvian National Armed Forces. Canada leads a NATO battle group in Latvia intended to deter and respond to threats posed by Russia.
In Lebanon, officials say Israeli airstrikes across the country killed at least 21 people. At least 15 people were killed in the southern Lebanese town of Kana. It has long been associated with civilian deaths after Israeli strikes during previous conflicts with Hezbollah. There was no immediate comment from the Israeli military on the strike late yesterday. Elsewhere, Israel resumed attacks in southern Beirut today amid concerns about possible attacks on the port, a pillar of Lebanon's economy.
Ukraine's president has presented his plan for victory against Russia. Volodymyr Zelensky told lawmakers in Kyiv today his vision includes an invitation for Ukraine to join NATO and receive permission to use Western-supplied longer-range missiles to strike military targets inside Russia. But those steps have been met with reluctance so far by Ukraine's allies. Zelensky also reiterated his country is not willing to make any trade-offs involving territory or sovereignty for an end to the fighting.
The U.S. is weighing in on the extraordinary diplomatic clash between Canada and India, refusing to directly condemn India. It comes after the RCMP says it linked several Indian diplomats to murder, blackmail, and harassment in Canada. Ottawa expelled six Indian officials. India responded by ousting six Canadian diplomats. Mounties say 30 people have been charged. India has denied the allegations. And CTV's Scott Hurst has been following the latest developments and joins us now. So, Scott, bring us up to date on the tension between Canada and India.
Nathan, this is an extraordinary diplomatic clash between Canada and India playing out very publicly and making headlines in both countries. And there is significant reaction and significant fallout. And we're learning much more of a timeline of events from Prime Minister Justin Trudeau as he is testifying in front of the Foreign Interference Inquiry. We're also learning that the Standing Committee on Public Safety and National Security has unanimously and officially called for an emergency meeting on the RCMP allegations against India. Now, from the Prime Minister, what we're learning as he is testifying in front of the Foreign Interference Committee, in the wake of the killing of Hardeep Singh Nijjar outside of a BC Gurdwara in June of 2023, the Prime Minister says Canada tried to reach out diplomatically about its concerns of Indian involvement, and this was, of course, behind the scenes diplomatic channels later that summer of 2023. Of course, that was framing with India hosting the G20 summit later that year in September, and Canada decided not to go public with these concerns before the summit and tried to continue to work behind the scenes at that summit. Near the end of that summit, the prime minister had a direct meeting with Indian Prime Minister Modi, and that is when he expressed Canada's concerns, saying that, admitting at the time, Canada was really going off of intel, not hard proof, and that culminated in that conversation where the Indian Prime Minister rebuffed some of Canada's calls and gone to express their concern about people living in Canada, outspoken about the Indian government. And so after that conversation with the Indian Prime Minister, that is when Justin Trudeau says they decided to go public last year about their concerns and the intel that they had. Here's more from the Prime Minister at the Foreign Interference Inquiry.
This was something that we obviously had to take extremely seriously. That violation of sovereignty, of the international rule of law, with extrajudicial killing in a foreign country, in a fellow democracy, was a massive mistake. If India had indeed done it, and we had reasons to believe that they had.
And Nathan, this is really stemming from a deepening divide and fallout from these allegations and Canada expelling six Indian diplomats, including the High Commissioner, and India retaliating by expelling six Canadian diplomats after the RCMP alleged that these people played a role in homicides, extortion, and other violent acts right here on Canadian soil, Nathan.
So, Scott, how might this situation be resolved?
Well, this will take significant diplomatic pressure, and also Canada is getting somewhat support from its allies, particularly south of the border. We heard the U.S. State Department yesterday. They refused to outwardly criticize India or condemn India, but so not an all-out show of support from the U.S. for Canada's very public position, but the U.S. did reinforce its position that India should cooperate with Canadian authorities. Here's more from the U.S. State Department spokesperson Matthew Miller.
When it comes to the Canadian matter, we have made clear that the allegations are extremely serious and they need to be taken seriously, and we wanted to see the government of India cooperate with Canada in its investigation. Obviously, they have not chosen that path.
And Nathan, all this is playing out as the Canadian government is trying to reassure the Canadian business community that this won't affect international trade. In fact, billions of dollars go back and forth every year. And representatives of the British Columbia Sikh Temple, where Hardeep Singh Nijjar was gunned down last year, and the Sikh independence group he was involved with, they're calling for more action from the Canadian government, demanding India's consulates in Vancouver and Toronto be shut down. Only then, they say, Nathan, their communities might feel a better sense of security.
All right, CTV's Scott Hurst, thank you.
Thanks, Nathan.
Meantime, the diplomatic feud between Canada and India is also generating reaction in Canada's South Asian community.
Some people claim they've been targets of violent extortion. CTV's Adrian Gobriel has the story.
The scenes of bullets barreling towards South Asian-owned businesses have become all too common across parts of Canada.
If you're growing your business, be very careful, because eventually these guys will get you.
For months, CTV News has been investigating multiple violent extortion attempts from Ontario to British Columbia that mainly target Sikh South Asian business owners. Over the last year, some Indo-Canadians, fearful for their lives, began wearing bulletproof vests before leaving their homes.
Are you wearing one right now?
Yes, I do.
Can we see it?
Yes.
Those we spoke with had their theories that Indian government officials may be working with organized crime groups to carry out extortion attempts. This week, for the first time, the RCMP confirmed they believe that to be true.
I mentioned previously the Lawrence Bishnoi gang that's involved in extortions and narcotics originating from India.
Bishnoi is a gang leader who's currently behind bars in India, where it's believed he's still able to operate his criminal enterprise.
Is sitting in a prison cell, is able to give live interviews to media channels, is able to go on his Facebook Live and provide commentaries.
That doesn't happen, in your opinion, without the Indian government allowing it.
Of course.
This past winter, CTV News spoke with an individual who claimed he'd carried out violent extortions while working for another organized crime figure in India.
How many targets have you hit? How many homes? How many businesses?
In Canada, like around, I think, 30 or 35.
This week's revelation by the RCMP has put a community, once again, on high alert.
We're not too far, from the reaches of a government of India when they're operating on Canadian soil.
The RCMP claimed that those who've been targeted are members of the Sikh Khalistan separatist movement, who the government in India have labeled as terrorists. Though many we've spoken with say Canadian Sikhs across the political spectrum have received extortion threats. Adrian Gobriel, CTV News, Brampton, Ontario.
Toronto police have arrested a suspect in a hate-motivated theft investigation. They say Israeli flags were taken from the same vehicle near the Queensway and North Queen in July and again on August 30th. 30-year-old Hussam Abu Hashim of Toronto has been charged with two counts of theft under $5,000.
Meanwhile, a separate arrest has been made after someone entered a mosque and uttered hate-motivated threats and slurs at people inside. This incident happened last Thursday at a mosque near Kennedy and Lawrence. 41-year-old Robin Licatos has been charged with harassment and uttering threats.
In response to the incident at the mosque, Mayor Olivia Chow released a statement which reads in part, "Toronto must be a place where people can feel safe, where they can be free to celebrate their culture, their identity, and to worship without fear. Together, we must recommit ourselves to making Toronto a place where people feel safe, a place where everyone belongs." Well, there's something new this fall to combat the potentially serious respiratory illness in kids known as RSV.
A vaccine is available for infants, and as CTV's Caitlin Wilson reports, parents are feeling relief.
It's a huge sports lover into everything at the moment.
Jessica Cohn's son, Eitan, is a happy, healthy 9-year-old with a zest for life.
He's really into superheroes, so it's sort of like, you know, do I have these superhero traits that help me to beat this?
When he was just a month old, he spent 2 weeks in intensive care diagnosed with RSV, or respiratory syncytial virus, a highly contagious respiratory illness that can have severe symptoms in babies and seniors.
It's just uncomfortable, you know, a baby that small is just struggling to breathe. And that's the scary thing about RSV, is that it can affect any baby.
Canada, now among the countries offering a wider range of protective products to fight off RSV this fall and winter, helping ease a healthcare system often overwhelmed by RSV.
This is a real game changer, because looking at other countries that have put it in as a publicly funded program, we're seeing an 80 to 85% reduction in hospitalizations.
According to Ontario's Ministry of Health, the infant RSV vaccine is now available at some locations across the province, with more shipments expected by the end of the month.
It is really an injection of what we call protective antibodies that protect the baby for a good period of time, particularly during the season. But you know what's even more important? It's going to be a reduction in parental anxiety and stress.
Officials say the vaccine will be available for free for all infants after birth and high-risk children up to 24 months. It's also covered for pregnant women between 32 and 36 weeks.
I think the bottom line is people should speak to their healthcare provider or their local public health unit to learn about what their options are this year.
And while it may be too late for parents like Jessica, she's hoping her story helps raise awareness.
You don't want to see your baby at a month old or younger have to be, you know, in the ICU hooked up to tubes. And I mean, luckily for us, things turned out okay, but it could have gone very differently.
Caitlin Wilson, CTV News.
In Ottawa, the ceremonial first poppy was presented to the Governor General this morning. The president of the Royal Canadian Legion pinned Right Honourable Mary Simon's poppy during a ceremony at Rideau Hall. The Legion says this marks the ceremonial start of its annual remembrance period. The National Poppy Campaign launches each year on the last Friday in October and will officially begin on October 25th this year. Funds donated locally are distributed locally to help support veterans and their families and communities and to promote remembrance. Jess.
Well, it's a very fall-like day as we head through this midpoint in our shortened work and school week. And temperature-wise, it is a little closer to seasonal, but still kind of cool out there. As we head into the afternoon, we'll see a decent amount of sunshine, but it is also going to still have that northwesterly wind, adding that cool breeze to the air. We'll sit at about 11. We should be at 13, and we're not quite there yet, but it's on the way. Coming up, I'll have a full look at your long-range forecast as we head in towards the weekend, and temperatures are on the rise.
All right, back to the forecast. And you were saying that it's not quite as chilly as yesterday. I did notice that, but it still is cool.
Isn't it funny with just a few degrees, the difference of just a few degrees? I mean, also, it hit us pretty hard yesterday because it was, you know, single digit was the high. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that extra few degrees, my kids were trying to, you know, not have to put a hat on today. They said, it's so much warmer. It's like, I don't know. Let me talk to Jess.
It is a little warmer, but a hat probably still a good idea. If you're an early riser, you definitely need those layers. It's, again, the time of year where you can probably wear the winter coat in the morning, the spring coat in the afternoon, a t-shirt in the early evening, and then you have to put those layers back on. But the good news is after today, we warm up and we stay warm. Weather is brought to you by the Presler Law Firm. Injury lawyers, you don't pay unless they win. Now, we're seeing all those beautiful fall colors out there, and it is fantastic. But we ran a story yesterday. I know everybody was watching, obviously, but we're not seeing as many because you need the cool air and you need the sunshine. And we've had sunshine, but we haven't had the cool air for all those fall colors to really shine through. So it is still beautiful out there, but we're not seeing as much as we normally do. But it was a great day to get out. A lot of people taking advantage of the fact that it wasn't, as we've been saying, as cold as yesterday morning, but still super fresh out there. And that northwesterly wind really has a lot to do with it. As we head into the day tomorrow, things will shift and a warm-up begins. We're sitting around 8 degrees right now, 10 through Windsor. We're all kind of holding on to those mid to upper single digits here in central and southern Ontario. As we head into the afternoon, yes, it is still below seasonal, but it is warmer than yesterday. And we're looking at a decent amount of sunshine off and on throughout the day. A little warmer in some areas, kind of towards, say, Niagara for us here in the city through London. But for the most part, we're between about 8 and 10 degrees. As we head into this evening, it's going to be cold. We're looking at some single digits and some negative temperatures. Yep. We're looking at 2 degrees for us here in the city. We're at -1 through Kingston. We're holding on to some minus temperatures through Goderich, through areas and towards Peterborough, Bancroft. And that has prompted some frost advisories into that southwestern corner and for us here in the city as we head through the overnight. So layers are definitely going to be necessary. We're holding on, though, to high pressure for the most part as we get through kind of the second half of our day today and in towards the end of the week. So something to look forward to. If you like the warmer fall weather, we have that and then some heading in towards the end of the week and the weekend. Not much in the way of any extreme active weather today, just some cloud cover holding on midday, and then as we head into the late afternoon, early evening, it clears out, and then we're just holding on to high pressure as we step through the overnight and into the day tomorrow, a much more stable air mass, making for a beautiful day on Thursday, on Friday, on Saturday, on Sunday. It only really gets nicer as we head in towards the end of the week. And again, I promise you the map still works. There's just absolutely nothing going on when it comes to cloud cover. It is cool today. We get back to seasonal as we head into our Thursday. And then beyond that, we get to 18, we get to 20, and we hold on in that 20-21 range from the weekend heading in towards the beginning of next week. So still pretty warm out there. Michelle, send it back to you.
Thank you, Jess. Still to come on CTV News, do you have your holiday shopping list ready yet? We're starting to get a gauge of how much consumers are planning to spend, even though the festivities are months away. Our Pat Foran will have those details.
An Ontario couple is celebrating a massive change in fortune after winning $40 million. Stephanie and Brian Cantwell split the $80 million jackpot, the largest in Canadian lottery history, with another winning ticket sold in Quebec. The couple was so shocked they didn't know what to do. They went to work as usual, but they say it didn't take long for news of their financial windfall to finally sink in.
Well, there's still Halloween shopping happening, and yet retailers are already looking ahead to the Christmas holiday shopping season.
A new survey finds consumers remain concerned about housing costs and credit card debt, but they still plan to spend more for the holidays. CTV's Pat Foran has the details.
It won't be long before shopping malls are decked out in holiday decorations, hoping to put consumers in a spending mood. A new survey from Deloitte Canada finds holiday spending is expected to increase by 10% to almost $1,500 this year. Despite some shoppers spending more, many will be looking for a bargain.
I'm going to try to spend about the same, but try to get more bang for the buck, basically. You know, you look around a little more.
I think you just kind of budget and you maybe do without some other things in order to be able to give gifts to the people you love.
With consumers looking for deals, many say they'll wait until Black Friday, which this year falls on November 29th.
The competition is going to be fierce. People are waiting till Black Friday because they're expecting those deals. In fact, 42% of Canadians think the best deals will be on or around Black Friday.
The survey found more Canadians plan to be charitable this holiday season, with donations up 35%, and travel spending is expected to jump 20% as more people say they plan to be away over the Christmas holidays.
Less gifts to buy, and I prefer to make memories and spend money on material things.
Trying to go away for the holidays as well, just to escape some of this expense.
Almost half of all shoppers will be buying something online, with 71% picking up something from Amazon. But now the number one online retailer will have some added competition. The survey found that 30% of consumers plan to use the newer online shopping options of Temu, Shein, and Alibaba.
You know, the prices are really, really low. So not only are they new and exciting and inspirational for shoppers, but they're also very good value.
Many shoppers are growing increasingly concerned about data breaches and their privacy. The survey found more shoppers are concerned about handing over their personal information to stores in case their account gets hacked. Pat Foran, CTV News.
A panel of medical and research experts says now is the time to prepare for the next pandemic. The call to action comes in a report called Time to Act. It was prepared by an expert panel to make sure we are prepared for the next global health crisis. Dr. Fahad Razak is one of the experts who co-authored the report. You might remember him from during the pandemic and all his expert advice. He's also an internist at St. Mike's Hospital in Toronto and one of the experts on the panel. Dr. Razak, great to have you with us. So many of us would love to just forget all those COVID years. And yet, as your report suggests, now's the time to act so we can avoid a tragedy on the scale we experienced. What aren't we doing now that we should be doing, given what we experienced?
Yeah, great to be with you. And, you know, like you, I think many of us in the healthcare system would like to forget what happened. And the goal of a report like this is to think critically through the process of what we experienced and to say, look, we don't know if it's going to be an infectious illness, if it's going to be wildfires like we had last summer with extreme air pollution days. But the expectation is there is going to be things that pressure our health system, create a crisis within our country in the future. How do you better prepare? And some of the areas that we identified is that in some respects, of course, Canada did quite well. We had lower mortality rate than many other countries, but there are opportunities for us to think through some of the preparation structures that could help us respond faster and stronger the next time. And one of the most important things is having those response structures ready, anticipating the kinds of risks that you may be presented with. So the idea of a risk register, which means you go out, you think systematically, could it be an infectious agent? Could it be a nuclear spill? Could it be a solar flare that knocks out communication lines? Canada doesn't have an extensive risk register to really think about those things. And that's the first step in order to prepare. The second is thinking about how the advisory should happen. So I was a member of the COVID-19 science advisory table here. That was something that was very much put together on the fly in response to a crisis. Ideally, you want bodies like this to be built ahead of time. You want the public to be aware that they're there. You want to think about the expertise on these bodies so that you have a very comprehensive and ready response that can spring into action.
Mm-hmm. So we were dealing with different groups, right, on different levels of government. So we don't have just one body who can oversee everything the next time around?
That's exactly right. And if you look at a comparator country like the United Kingdom, for example, they have a single overall advisory structure at the federal level that also ties into states or provinces or territories as we have here in Canada. And that structure is ready ahead of time. And for a country of Canada's size, that can be really important, for example, for smaller communities. So here in Ontario, we have large universities, a large population. We were able to put together our own expert body. But smaller provinces like Nova Scotia, for example, may not have the same capacity. So you want a single structure for the country. It also reduces the discommunication, the differences that occur between policies of the federal government, the provincial government, or a territorial government, because one of the challenges you face is lots of information streams coming into the public. It's easy to get confused. It's easy for misinformation or disinformation to arise. You want to try and bring that together as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. And when people have to act quickly, and you have, I mean, we were fighting the virus, but then there also was disinformation and public trust. And after what we experienced, how do you get that trust back?
So one of the critical parts about getting trust back, we believe, is having the ability to communicate information scientifically as you see it to the public transparently. It was one of the policies we followed at the science table, but it's difficult to do. And the reason it's difficult is sometimes that evidence is incomplete. Remember, this was an illness that never existed, newly emerged in 2019. Who gets sick? How sick will they be? What's an effective treatment? Does a mask work? What about social distancing? These are questions that had to be figured out on the fly. Often when we put together recommendations, they were incomplete. They were based on best available evidence. And if you don't share that with the public, if you say, okay, we have some evidence, we're not ready to share it, that's what creates that gap where misinformation and disinformation can enter the space. We believe the most important thing to do, and this is based on behavioral science and other studies, is to communicate that information out, acknowledge where it's imperfect or where it's evolving, and improve it over time, and say, if in 3 months' time we change a recommendation, it's because of this new study. We gave you the best we had at the time we had it. Here's this new part of evidence that's now going to change the recommendation. That's difficult for government as well, because remember, they're trying to create cohesive policies to guide us. What happens if that policy is true today, but less true or potentially changes a week from now?
Well, it's certainly reassuring that there's a panel of experts thinking about all of these things. Dr. Farhad Razack, that's all the time we have for today. Best of luck implementing these insights.
Thanks. Great to be with you.
Take care.
Still to come, inflation is down once again, and there's hope the cost of borrowing for a car, loan, or a mortgage will follow. We'll have that story after the break.
Get Toronto's top stories, breaking news alerts, and watch live. Download the CTV News app.
Well, some good news for Canadians dealing with the high cost of living. The annual inflation rate fell to 1.6% last month, mainly because drivers are paying less for gas.
CTV's Paul Hollingsworth reports on what that could mean for borrowing rates.
The financial picture in Canada is slowly improving, and there's reason for continued optimism looking ahead.
We're seeing inflationary pressures come down. We have seen the labor market really weakening off in the last number of months, except for the latest month, the very latest month, where we saw a kind of resurgence in employment numbers.
All eyes will now be on the Bank of Canada's next interest rate announcement on October 23rd. A larger rate cut could be in the works.
It's possible that the bank acts more, more aggressively and lowers rates more quickly.
Canadian consumers are also getting a break at the pumps. Gasoline prices in September dropped 10.7% compared to 12 months earlier. However, the inflation news is not all good. Rent prices increased 8.2%. Mortgage interest costs in September were up 16.7% compared to September 2023. Groceries rose 2.4% in September, a faster climb compared to the overall inflation rate. This shopper is not finding many affordable deals.
I don't see it. I don't see it at all.
Sylvain Charlebois says it's difficult to predict when food prices will drop. There are two main factors keeping the cost of groceries from climbing even higher.
Energy costs and our dollar. Those are the two things that are keeping food inflation at bay. If, say, a barrel of oil would have actually gone up to over $80 or $90 because of what's going on in the Middle East, we would have been in trouble.
Charlebois says rising wholesale prices are causing meat, dairy, and produce to continue to climb in cost. Paul Hollingsworth, CTV News, Halifax.
Uranium stocks surged today on yet another deal that will see an internet giant buy into nuclear power.
Andrew Bell of BNN Bloomberg brings us the latest in business.
Hello there. Here are your business headlines. Shares in uranium producer Cameco rose 7%, and Denison Mines jumped almost 10% in Toronto trading this morning. Amazon and billionaire financier Ken Griffin are among the backers of a $500 million investment in small nuclear reactors. Tech companies are hungry for new energy supplies to power their massive data centers. Google this week announced its own deal to invest in small reactors. Shares in Toronto-listed Lithium Americas climbed 18%. General Motors will expand its latest investment in the miners' Thacker Pass project in Nevada to more than $600 million. This gives the automaker an ownership stake in the mine, producing a critical ingredient for electric vehicle batteries. Washington has already made a commitment, a preliminary commitment, of more than $2 billion to support Thacker Pass. And finally, North American crude oil slipped below $70 US a barrel, with many traders pessimistic about the market outlook for next year. New supply is flowing from the US, Brazil, Guyana, and Canada, and that's without counting a planned production boost by OPEC+. That's the latest in business. I'm Andrew Bell of BNN Bloomberg.
The greatest goal scorer in the history of soccer played her final match on home soil last night.
And Christine Sinclair left another huge impression on the pitch in Vancouver.
The header down, Sinclair scores!
Sinclair scored for her Portland Thorns against the Vancouver Whitecaps FC Girls Elite last night at BC Place. Her team went on to win 6-0. This is Sinclair's final season with the NWSL's Thorns. Next year, she'll join the ownership group of the Vancouver Rise ahead of the inaugural Northern Super League season.
Hockey goalies don't score very often, but when they do, it's pretty remarkable.
Vucinovic fires in, looking for a goalie goal. Gustafson scores!
Minnesota's Philip Gustafson capped the Wild's 4-1 win over the St. Louis Blues, lobbing the puck into an empty net. It's his first goal and the 18th goalie goal in NHL history.
Coming up, a close call and fall for pop star Olivia Rodrigo.
Pop star Olivia Rodrigo reassured fans after falling through a trapdoor on stage this week. She is fine. Video of the mishap during her show in Melbourne was shared online. Rodrigo bounced right back up and ended up finishing the performance.
Now to a heartwarming story about a son who's doing what he can to support his father. CTV's Adam Sawatsky has the story.
Ian's on a journey that began beyond the street, playing sports with his dad.
Yeah, shooting pucks in the backyard, throwing the baseball in the backyard.
Before that, backpacking as a baby. And later, countless bike rides.
Loved it. Yeah, those are some of my fondest memories as a kid.
As an adult, Ian still finds it fun to push himself physically, his dad, Ross, says.
And he's an extremely hard worker. He's very focused.
And Ian was focused on his life moving forward, at work as a firefighter, at home as a father and husband, when suddenly, all he could focus on was the phone call from his dad.
No one ever really wants to hear that, you know, your dad has a terminal disease.
Ross was diagnosed with ALS, was slowly losing control of his muscles, and the son who'd always looked for help from his dad started focusing on finding help for him.
You know, one thing my dad always taught me, you know, be positive, have a positive attitude.
So Ian decided to raise money for ALS research by cycling around the city for 24 hours straight.
I'm just blown away by it. Yeah, totally blown away.
Bye.
Ian began with the overnight leg of the ride, cycling 300 kilometers around the Victoria Airport for 12 hours straight.
It was cold, I was tired, again pretty delirious through some parts of the night.
Yet Ian kept going, riding around Greater Victoria for another 12 hours straight, reflecting on how his increasing discomfort could never compare to what his dad was enduring.
It wasn't really a question of if I was going to do it or not, it was just, had to do it.
By then, Ian had more than surpassed his goal of raising $18,000. And after cycling nonstop for 24 hours, riding almost 600 kilometers straight, the dad he'd done it all for was overwhelmed with gratitude.
In tears, really, so proud of you. Just a swelling in your chest. I mean, I don't know what else to say.
What can you say when you see that the baby you once carried on your back had grown up to become the man who'd always have your back? Always. Adam Sawatsky, CTV News, North Saanich.
That's a great story.
That is so beautiful. Let's continue. The warm feelings. Bring some warmth.
It is coming as we head throughout the rest of this kind of short work and school week. So if you do like cooler weather for cycling, we have that today. If you like warmer weather for cycling, we have that tomorrow. So something for everybody this week. We're in that time of year where you have to at least pack in your bags jacket for cooler weather, warmer weather, and then what you need in the afternoon. As we make our way through today, we do see high pressure start to clear things out, and we will see more sunshine into the afternoon before the sun sets this evening, right around 6:30 p.m. It's happening earlier and earlier. Sitting at 8 degrees now, 10 in Niagara, 10 in Windsor, and 7 out through Ottawa. As we head in towards the evening tonight, it's going to be cold. We're sitting at just 2 degrees, but we do that slow but steady warm-up as we head throughout the rest of the week. We're holding on to temperatures into the 20s as we head into the weekend, and then we stay there as we head into the beginning of next week. So, yes, we've had a taste of the cooler, more traditional fall weather, but it was short-lived, and we are back into the 20s before the week is all said and done.
Great. Thank you, Jess. And that is CTV News at Noon. Remember, you can get Toronto's breaking news all day long on CP24 and at ctvnewstoronto.ca.
For Jessica Smith and the whole team here, have a pleasant afternoon. I'm Michelle Dubé.
And I'm Nathan Downer. Be sure to join us later for CTV News at 5 and 6. Have a great afternoon.